Welcome, everyone. If you find yourself here, it is very auspicious, for you are engaging in the great struggle. The struggle to fix your attention on the highest advice possible. This is a struggle you have to prevail in. You have to win this struggle. And it is a struggle. There's no question about it. But what we are doing here is giving a boost for the struggle, helping a, you know, boost for this great effort. All thanks to Longchenpa for giving us this boost. And ultimately, all thanks to the Holy Spirit, which my view is that the Holy Spirit is the only teacher there really is. The Holy Spirit will stay with all of us to the very end, till we're all liberated. And all teachers that arise are really helping the Holy Spirit out, helping the grace of God out to get us to fix our attention on the highest advice possible, even the advice of Longchenpa, which is very high indeed. In fact, I think it's the highest advice you're going to come across in terms of expression. I call it fourth phase teaching, fourth phase advice. And it basically evaporates everything. It evaporates Buddhism. It evaporates Dzogchen. It evaporates radical Dzogchen, which may be the same thing as saying Dzogchen. It evaporates words. It evaporates sentences. It evaporates expression. It evaporates itself. And leaves us where? Leaves us in freedom. So certainly we want to fix our attention on this as best we can. And of course it's going to be a struggle. That's the whole point of it. So you who are engaging in this struggle, you get it. You know, ask yourself, am I getting it? You do get it. Engaging in the struggle to fix our attention upon the highest teaching possible, that is getting it. That is doing it. It's that simple. But that doesn't, saying this doesn't make it any easier, does it? And so, here we go again. Well, that's nice, isn't it? It's so light that it can't even show up. That's beautiful. Spaciousness. Somewhere there's a title here. It is spaciousness, the radical Dzogchen of the Vajra heart. Longchenpa's precious treasury of the Dharma Dhatu, the sphere of essential reality. Again, this evaporates itself. So don't be alarmed if you think, hey, what's he doing? He's evaporating the teaching. He's evaporating religion. He's evaporating Buddhism. He's evaporating all of this. Why? Yeah, absolutely. That's what needs to happen. Okay, so in the mood of repentance, very humble, acknowledging we have one severe problem, the continuity problem. And the continuity problem is the only problem that there is. And there's only one cure for that, and that's the vision of oneness. From a pragmatic standpoint, our goal is the vision of oneness. That is our goal. Everything arises in the vast matrix of spontaneity. And spontaneity is the ground of everything, but empty in essence, never crystallizing. The ground is nothing, although it appears as everything. Samsara and nirvana arise as spontaneity in the Trikaya threefold matrix, yet they can never stir from their intrinsic spaciousness, for such are the blissful fields of reality. The nature of mind is an unchanging sky-like supermatrix, a matrix of variable display, compassionate magical emanation. Everything is ornamentation of spaciousness and nothing else. It is the creativity of luminous mind, pulsating outward and inward, being nothing at all, yet appearing as everything whatsoever. And it paints magnificent, amazing, magical emanation. Outside and inside, and the material and spiritual dimensions, are ornaments of spaciousness, arising as the wheel of sublime form. All sounds and speech, everything that vibrates, are ornaments of spaciousness, arising in essence as sublime vibration. All movement of thought and all inconceivable non-thought are ornaments of spaciousness arising as the wheel of sublime mind. The six kinds of mythic beings, moreover, with four types of birth, can never stray an iota from the spaciousness of their reality. And the six fields of dualistic sense perception of the universe, appearing in their own spaciousness like magical illusion, do not truly exist. Baseless, vividly apparent, yet empty in the now, supremely spacious, with natural clarity, they appear as decoration of their own intrinsic spaciousness. No matter what the perception arising in this vast spaciousness, in its unremitting sameness, it is the Dharmakaya of luminous mind, disposed in the now, empty in itself, unchanging, unsublimating, as self-sprung awareness in the now, reality itself, effortlessly, passively, it is part of the one blissful matrix. In its unchanging intrinsic clarity, it is Sambhogakaya, and however is manifests, and however it should be it, it manifests, it is spontaneity. Oh, there's a little typo. Gee. We can keep going, can't we? Uncontrived and unalloyed in its unremitting sameness. Whatever the shape of the distinct multifarious display, its reality is self-sprung emanation, magical projection, and it never strays from the non-action of the all-good. In the fail-safe luminous mind, the unfabricated Trakaya is already perfected, not stirring from spaciousness. Its spontaneity uncompromised. The activity of Buddha in Buddha fields is already perfected. The matrix of sublime spontaneity dawns in the now. Universal multiplicious diversity perfected in the now. This field of unalterable, unsublimating spontaneity in the now, this is the visible reality of intrinsic spaciousness, non-crystallizing knowledge arising to ornament that spaciousness, already arrived, nothing to do, without any practice, like the sun in the sky. That is an amazing, superb reality. Here, in this womb-like spaciousness, in the spontaneity of the now, samsara is all good, and while nirvana is also good, in this all-good matrix, in the now, neither samsara nor nirvana exist. Appearances are all good, and while emptiness is also all good, in this all-good matrix, in the now, neither appearance nor emptiness exists. Life is all good, and while good and bad feelings are also all good, in this all good matrix, neither life nor feelings exist. Self and other are both all good, And while acceptance and rejection are also all good, in this all good matrix, no self and other, no affirmation or negation is possible. In delusion, we reify what is not truly existent and label it. Why is it that we so readily affix attributes to samsara and nirvana when their nature is so dreamlike, baseless, and evanescent? Everything is all good, magnificent spontaneity, and delusion, never having existed in the past, existing neither in the present nor the future. Life is just a label, the paradox of being and non-being resolved. No one has ever been deluded anywhere in the past, no one is deluded now, and no one will ever be deluded in the future. This is the alpha pure vision of past, present, and future. When delusion is non-existent, non-delusion cannot exist. And spontaneously in the now, pure presence is right here. Since there never was release, is no release now, and never will be, nirvana is a mere label, and no one has ever known liberation. There can be no release because no confinement can exist in the now. And pure like the sky, nothing can ever be restricted or localized. This is alpha pure vision of ultimate liberation. In short, in the spontaneity of this vast womb-like spaciousness, what seems to be samsara or nirvana is a display of creativity that at its very inception is neither samsara nor nirvana. Further, no matter what dream arises in the creativity of sleep, it is in truth an absence, a blissful rest in natural presence, smoothly spaced out in vast, unremitting sameness. The spaciousness that is pristine spontaneity pervades everything, joining outside and inside. It has no boundaries, top or bottom, and is beyond direction. As pure presence, it is clear like the sky, non-spatial, non-dual. As the vast matrix itself, it is beyond pulsating thought and image. The magical illusion that emanates within this unborn spaciousness, quite indeterminate, without any definition whatsoever, cannot be denominated as something, for it has no substance or attribute. Insofar as its sky-like nature fills space-time, it is unborn spontaneity, no before or after, no beginning or end. The nature of all samsara and nirvana is this luminous mind, unmanifest, unproduced, indeterminate spontaneity, coming from nowhere and going nowhere. The matrix of luminous mind indicates neither past nor future, for it is unvarying in its all-pervasive uniformity. Reality, just as it is, without beginning, middle, or end, an all-pervasive smoothness, is sky-like in nature. Without either beginning or end, it supersedes linear time. Without origination or cessation, it can have neither substance nor attribute. It is invariable, so it cannot be denominated as anything. It cannot be induced or practiced, so nothing is to be done. And without mass or volume, it is the ground of suchness. Unimaginable and unassailable, it is the matrix of sameness. Since sameness is the reality of all things, everything necessarily rests in the matrix of sameness. This luminous mind is a singularity in which all is equal. And since its all-pervasive smoothness is like unmanifest space, within that gamut of sameness, there can be no intervention. This fortress of non-temporal spontaneity, all-pervasive, this fortress of the vast matrix of the now without top, bottom, or middle, this fortress of the unborn Dharmakaya, impartially all-accommodating, this fortress of the precious secret that is unchanging spontaneity, this fortress of the now, the entire galaxy, samsara, and nirvana, this is the totality, the single denominator. Upon a zero-dimensional, all-pervasive foundation stands the palace of luminous mind, samsara and nirvana identical. At its marvelously high pinnacle is the vast matrix of reality, the center of an uncreated, omnidimensional panorama, a wide-open doorway to freedom from graduated endeavor. Within that palace, arrayed with spontaneously amassed wealth, the king's self-sprung awareness takes his throne. His pulsating projections, emanations of his pristine awareness, serve as ministers who govern his domain. The holy queen, innate meditative absorption, attends. With spontaneous guru vision, her offspring and her servants, all centered in the pure pleasure matrix of intrinsic non-conceptual clarity. Within that still ineffable plenum, the king masters all manifest and potential appearances, and the immense dominion of vast spaciousness is his. I'm going to bump this up just a little bit. Okay. Living in that land, everything is Dharmakaya. Never straying from our unitary self-sprung awareness in the now, seizing the uncreated now beyond striving and practice, encompassed by the one soul sphere that has no hard edges, just as we are centered in that undifferentiated, all-inclusive matrix. Since the six mythic realms and even the Buddha fields shine nowhere but in that sky-like reality, in that inherently clear luminous mind, they are of one taste. And samsara and nirvana are naturally assimilated to pure presence. In this treasury of existential spaciousness, the universal source, nirvana, unsought, is the constant spontaneity of the now. So given the Dharmakaya as unchanging, non-referential, all-investing, internal and external visions, all life forms are the Sambhogakaya. And the Nirmanakaya is like naturally occurring reflection. So all experience necessarily ornamenting the three kayas, the three spiritual qualities of reality, it is all empty, physical, energetic, and mental display. And the countless Buddha fields, likewise, without exception, all arise from the same source, the nature of mind, the Trikaya matrix. The contents of samsara, the six realms and their inhabitants, also surely are mere reflections within intrinsic spaciousness. All the phantasmagoria of life and death, pleasure and pain, like apparitional show, abound in the matrix of mind in itself, apparent yet insubstantial and hence truly non-existent. It occurs through adventitious circumstance, like moisture condensing as clouds, neither existent nor non-existent, beyond determinate extremes. It is the nature of mind, the essential luminous mind, pure like the sky, free of birth and death, pleasure and pain, unaffected by materiality, is indifferent to samsara and nirvana. It cannot be indicated as something, for it is a vast, sky-like matrix. Unchanging and incapable of sublimation, it is unalloyed spontaneity. Buddha lies in the Vajra heart that is clear light, where everything is fields of self-sprung bliss. Everything the unremitting sameness of that supreme light. Since luminous mind excludes nothing whatsoever, so all experience is of the nature of luminous mind. The simile for luminous mind is sky-like, because that mind has no cause and cannot be objectified. It has no location. It is ineffable and beyond ideation. So the spaciousness of the sky is an apt metaphor. If the metaphor denotes anything specific, how could it evoke anything definite? If the metaphor denotes nothing specific, how could it evoke anything definite? Understand that the sky is a metaphor for natural purity. What is evoked is the sky-like intrinsic presence of luminous mind. Incapable of verbalization, defying illustration and description, such is the vast matrix of intrinsic clarity, motionless, clear light, uncontrived spontaneity without status or dimension. It is the Dharmakaya, the wide open center of the luminous heart. It is evinced by whatever arises as creativity. At its point of inception, without base or creator, what does arise, being mere label, vanishes into spaciousness when identified, assimilated into undifferentiated virginal sameness, free of perceptual duality. It is the matrix of spaced-out smoothness. This zero-dimensional reality of self-sprung awareness in the now, revealed by analogy, well-defined similitude, evocation, and evidence, the very essence denoted by these three beautiful sky bolts, assimilates everything without differentiation or exclusion. It is the womb-like space of this vast expanse of equality. In the now, everything is always the same, without temporal or qualitative distinction. That is the vision of the Samantabhadra Vajrasattva. Luminous mind is like the solar nucleus. Its nature is clear light, forever uncompounded. Nothing can veil its translucent spontaneity. And as unthought reality, elaborate variation is impossible. The Dharmakaya as emptiness, the Sambhogakaya as clarity, and the Nirmanakaya as radiance are the three kayas. Yet they can never be united or separated. And since in the now their potential is wrought in spontaneity, darkening flaws and faults cannot veil them. They are identical in their changelessness and timelessness, identical in their saturation of Buddhas and sentient beings alike, identical as self-sprung luminous mind. the creativity of that luminous mind occurs as any damn thing, as thought or non-thought, as manifestation or potential, as diverse and various as a living being's perceptions. Things appear, but they never crystallize. Everything is like a mirage, dream, echo, like apparition, reflection in water and castles in the sky, like hallucination. Things are clearly apparent, but do not truly exist. Know all experience as rootless and baseless, mere adventitious appearance, just ephemeral occurrence, circumstantial and contingent. In the spontaneous nature of luminous mind, the display non-crystallizing samsara and nirvana emanate magically to be assimilated simultaneously into its spaciousness. Know that display does not stray from its original natural perfection. Here and now, everything lies within the scope of luminous mind. Perfect in its oneness, perfect in its all-inclusiveness. Everything perfect in its natural, uncontrived reality. As perfection, it is self-sprung awareness in the now. Since luminous mind is neither visible nor invisible, neither outer nor inner, samsara can exist. Samsara nor nirvana can exist concretely. Yet by virtue of its dynamic creativity, the myriad display, the material and spiritual dimensions, samsara and nirvana shine out. Forms that at their very inception are essentially empty, unborn but appearing to be born, appear yet nothing whatsoever has been created. Nothing crystallizes, although it may appear to do so. And that non-crystallizing illusion is the form of emptiness. Even in its apparent stability, nothing really subsists. For groundless and changeless, whatever appears, and however it appears, it can never be substantiated, and so it is labeled simply insubstantial. Since appearances appear by themselves in creativity, they are said symbolically to be synchronicious. Arising in creativity, at the very moment of inception, no arising or non-arising can be said to occur, no time or space. So creativity is a mere symbol word designating nothing. Since nothing neither alters nor sublimates, how can it move an iota out of luminous mind? Luminous mind is not appearance. It goes beyond appearance. It is not simply emptiness. It goes beyond emptiness. It is not truly existent. It has no concrete attribute. It is not non-existent. It pervades all samsara and nirvana. Neither is nor is not. Its unremitting sameness is pristine spaciousness. And without root, base, or substance, it is non-spatial and non-temporal. Pure presence, unbreakable, is the luminous matrix. Sky-like spaciousness, unalterable and unchangeable, saturates the now. As self-sprung awareness in the now, incommensurate in the now, unborn, unceasing, it is contained in the one soul sphere, indeterminate, all-embracing, It is zero-dimensional. The Vajrahart's core, motionless, unremitting sameness, all-suffusing supreme spaciousness, neither doable nor undoable. This is not a domain that can be described in words. Insight welling up as the presence intrinsic in every field. The adept, free of discursive elaboration, vocal and mental, convinced that every field of experience is ineffable, entertaining neither meditation nor any object of meditation, need not eliminate either depressed or elated thought. In the reality of empowering being in the now, where concepts of self and others do not govern us, the three realms in themselves are Buddha fields of sameness. The victors of all time are self-envisioned purity, and everything indiscriminately partaking of that totality. Not an iota of anything is to be attained elsewhere. All experience effulgent in the vast matrix of mind's nature. There is not the slightest movement out of actual sameness. Without inside or outside, without disturbing pulsation, luminous mind as the source dispels the darkness of extremes. And without the need of doing anything, precludes any deviation. People's unrealized strobe-like perception in the mundane world, in awareness of sublime forms in the now that is pure Buddha, both arise within the creativity of pure presence, as non-congealing display permeated by sky-like spaciousness. Insofar as there can be realization of that spaciousness, or its absence, realization affords the pure perception of blissful Buddha, while non-realization delivers the ignorant dualistic propensities that manifest multifariously, yet still never stray from spaciousness. Luminous mind is the actual condition of everything. And attributes uncrystallizing, no matter what their variation, it is evident as the pure spaciousness of inherently clear reality, without sharpness or blur, as unrestricted pure presence. This self-sprung spacious matrix is translucent awareness in the now. It is the clear light unveiled without any outside or inside. Intrinsic presence is thus a marvelous mirror of mind. And intrinsic spaciousness is a precious wish-fulfilling gem, since everything occurs naturally without any quest. Self-sprung awareness in the now is the glorious source of fulfillment. Whatever innumerable transcendent qualities can be divined, all arise out of spaciousness as spaciousness, and all arise as sublime, non-crystallizing, skillful means. As unborn spaciousness, everything is spontaneously perfected, all material things transfigured by the emptiness of the luminous matrix, the emptiness adorned by the intrinsic presence of the luminous matrix. In luminous mind in the now, there is no duality of appearance and emptiness. And in that non-dual detachment, far-out magical illusion appears. Unborn spaciousness, lacking any time frame, remains an immutable matrix, undivided and uncompounded. And Buddha of all time, as awareness of pure presence, a luminous matrix of intrinsic presence, saturating dualistic perception, without inside or outside, reality is spacious spontaneity. In the nature of mind, the luminous mind, there is no view or meditation and no disciplinary training. No goal to achieve, no stages or paths to traverse. No mandala to create, no recitation of mantra, no fulfillment stage. No empowerment to receive, and no samaya to protect. In the pure reality that is the spontaneity of the now, we are free of progressive, goal-oriented practices. Yet the nature of those practices is luminous mind, for the sun is always shining in spaciousness, notwithstanding the veiling adventitious cloud. The 10 goal-oriented techniques are taught in response to creativity's chance delusion. As antidotes for those captivated by gradual progress, it is not taught to adepts with genuine experience, to those knowing the reality of Adi Yoga's Vajra heart. To draw goal-oriented people striving on a graduated path towards the pristine spaciousness of reality, the disciples, hermits, and bodhisattvas' approaches, the three lower vehicles, are taught in succession. The Kriya Tantra, Upa Tantra, and Yoga Tantra approaches. The three median vehicles automatically follow. And finally, Mahayoga, Anuyoga, and Adi Yoga. The three higher approaches are imminently evident. Through the door of the progressive causal approaches, fortunate beings are brought to threefold luminosity. The ultimacy of all approaches, however, is the Vajra heart, that marvelous sublime secret that all do share, the apex that is unchanging supreme clear light, celebrated as the revelation of the luminous heart. Gradualists with discriminating moral endeavor try to extinguish propensities manifesting as mind and mental events that already naturally arise as a shining creative display. They aspire to purify the mind that is already pristine awareness. The Supreme View makes no call upon discriminating endeavor. For in reality, direct encounter with the essence is inescapable. Self-sprung awareness is the nature of luminous mind. It is unnecessary desperately to search for it far afield. Simply stay in yourself. You will find it nowhere else. We know that reality itself, like the sun, stays forever in its natural state of all-embracing clear light. Believing in their attempt to illuminate darkness, others try to imitate the illuminating primordial sun. The causal view is quite different from the supreme view. Today, some dinosaurs, taking pride in their Ati Yoga, believe sophisticated thought to be luminous mind. Such fools are lost in a dark pit, self-exiled from the natural great perfection, ignorant of the great creativity and the display of luminous mind. How is it possible that they can know the luminous mind? Here, we know that the Alpha Pure Luminous Mind, the true reality that is ultimate spaciousness, beyond thought and speech, is perfect insight. We know it as inherently unmoving, intrinsic clear light. In the now, free of all discursive elaboration, it is what we mean by essence, analogous to the solar nucleus. Its creativity is non-crystallizing, unceasing pure presence. Transparent and unlimited, free of conceptual and critical thought, shining with constant clarity, free of dualistic perception. Creativity's pure presence entails intellectual functions, including dualistic perception and its manifold propensities. The five sense objects, reifications of objects in a non-existent field, and the five afflictive emotions, effects of a self that has no identity, and all the delusory perceptions of outer universe and inner being. Samsara also emerges from creativity. In air, we are caught in reified perceptual appearances. With the realization that the supermatrix of reality comes from nowhere, goes nowhere, and stays nowhere, the vision of the total liberation of the three realms, the transmission of Ati, the spontaneity of the Vajra heart, arises in the matrix of the magnificent vastness of the All Good. Within the essence of immaculate, luminous mind, there is nothing to see and no act of seeing. Nothing to look at and no one to look. No mind to meditate and nothing to meditate upon. Because the conception and the act are one in spontaneity, not even a hint of a goal nor rumor of a destination occurs. Because an indeterminate Dharma has no structure, there can never be a path to a goal. Because the clear light is already a non-dual sphere, no mandala need be visualized by pulsating thought. No mantra, no recitation, no empowerment, no samaya, and no gradual dissolution in the fulfillment stage. Immaculate Buddha in Buddha fields, already present in the now, cannot be created by causal concatenation. If complex causality reigns, self-sprung awareness is precluded. For what is compounded is subject to destruction. And how can that be called simple spontaneity? So in the nature of ultimate spaciousness, beyond causality, Tantra's 10 techniques are redundant. Know that the genuine nature of mind, unmotivated, diffuses all proliferating, critical, discursive thought. Just as all sunlight is considered the nature of the sun, so all experience is the nature of luminous mind. Identify the spaciousness of the support and location of whatever arises, including the entire impure, delusory universe, manifest or potential, and everything is suffused by baseless mind and released in the now. Reality is thus defined as the vast space of the matrix of the now, beyond delusion and non-delusion, beyond nominal meaning. Even sublime self-envisioned forms and Buddha fields and the display of wholly appropriate activity in present awareness are contained in the self-sprung space that is neither unity nor disunity. Luminous mind comprises the entire universe and samsara and nirvana, all of it non-composite, empty clarity, like sun-dash space, all of it the vast, pristine, self-sprung matrix of the now. The vast matrix of mind's nature, an unchanging sky-like space, with the creativity of luminous mind indeterminate in its display, governs all the lifestyles of samsara and nirvana. The single principle of non-action underpinning it all. So nothing is extreme, nothing excluded or extraneous, for nothing can stray from the reality of luminous mind. Because everything arises as unitary, all-good spontaneity, as an all-inclusive, unrivaled, supreme embodiment, the greatest of the great, as all good intrinsic spaciousness, like an emperor magisterially embodying the state, the whole of samsara and nirvana is passively unmoving. Because all things are all good, and not one is not good, undifferentiated, all things have one value in the all good. Because the true and the false have one value in intrinsic spaciousness, everything is identical in the unmoving sameness of spontaneity. All, without exception, arises out of the unity of intrinsic spaciousness, where in non-action neither quest nor practice can be. Effort and endeavor are only their own intrinsic spaciousness. So whence could effort arise, and to what could endeavor aspire? No place to go, no vision to cultivate, no state to attain, nothing extraneous to assimilate, no coming nor going, the sameness of the Dharmakaya, spontaneous perfection, lies in the spaciousness of the one soul sphere. Disciples, hermits, and bodhisattvas' transmissions, conveying strong conviction in the absence of I and mine, provide a shared, unelaborated, sky-like vision. The transmission of the supreme yoga, Ati, the sublime secret, identifies the vast space where self and other are inseparable. With the self-sprung awareness of things in the now, just as they are, thus including the view of the lower approaches in its supreme essence. The three disciplines of Kriya Tantra, Upa Tantra, and Yoga Tantra, relating the yogin to the deity through contemplation and offering, all aspire to the city of immaculate body, speech, and mind. In the Vajra Peak transmission, the sovereign secret, form, sound, and awareness already immaculate, comprise the deity of the now. The city of immaculate body, speech, and mind already revealed. The vision of the lower approaches is contained in the supreme essence. In Mahayoga, Anuyoga, and Ati Yoga, fields of Yabhyam deities constitute the universe of appearances, spiritual and material. And since intrinsic spaciousness is inseparable from immaculate primal awareness in the now, in this most sublime secret, everything is already immaculate. And the vast uncreated matrix of the now is an actual field of bliss. In that all-pervasive plenum, without outside or and inside, no discriminating progressive endeavor can stand. And since everything is submerged in the now, liberated in the vast matrix of the Dharmakaya, those lower visions are gathered into the secret heart of Ati. Complete in one, complete in some, the matrix that contains all possible experience, itself is contained in magnificent spontaneity, in its intrinsic clarity, disposed in the now. The transmission of luminous mind occurs as natural spontaneity. It is the immediate fulfillment at the summit of Mount Meru, the most exalted, supreme, sovereign, existential modality. When we reach the summit of a towering mountain, the lands below are visible at a glance. From below, the ambience of the peak is unknown. Likewise, at the Vajra heart of Maha Ati, in the apex approach, all values are clearly apparent. While from the lower approaches, the peak is invisible, it is the peak experience that is spontaneity. Spontaneity is the miraculous wish-fulfilling gem that in its very nature will provide merely by the asking. Although it is not so for dilettantes people, the Drakaya is the spontaneity of the Vajra heart, for Buddha is already accomplished in its quiescent spaciousness. Without the need of any effort or practice, therein lies its greatness. In the lower approaches, stressful discrimination is applied. Yet nothing is accomplished for eons except desperate neurosis. In the now, luminous mind, the unremitting sameness of pure presence, left alone just as it is, the wide open spacious reality, that is our Dharmakaya nature, the sameness of a pristine matrix. Present in all, but recognized only by the fortunate few, simply by relaxing into it, its innate disposition is revealed. As all-pervasive natural clarity, spontaneity is the Sambhogakaya. Present in all, it is the homeland seen only by a few, letting alone whatever manifest divulges it. The non-crystallizing display. The Nirmanakaya is again a pervasive matrix. Present everywhere, shining clear at its inception, it is a magical display of wish-fulfilling qualities and appropriate activity, and the matrix of immaculate intrinsic presence is like that. Like water when the sediment has settled, natural purity revealed. Alpha pure experience cannot be found by conscious search, for the Buddha High shines in a self-sprung matrix. We need not work for it, we have it already. Its inherent greatness is the vision of the reality matrix. Do not strive for what is inescapable spontaneity. The ground of the now, gratuitous ground, that is the heart, the ground that is the luminous heart. Since we can never separate from our own nature, we cannot move from the pure presence of the clear light matrix. The reason that everything is perfected by simply letting it be resides in the indomitable master that is fivefold pristine awareness, physical, energetic, mental, qualitative, and active perfection, each fivefold. All this is the original Buddha, the spontaneity of the vast primordial matrix. Do not search elsewhere. Buddha is already right here. The luminous Dharmakaya of Buddha, moreover, can be nothing other than immutable sameness. And since it is the spontaneity of this very self-sprung space, don't search for it. Don't practice it. Let go of spiritual ambition. Since the sentient being self-sprung awareness in the now remains a spontaneity in the uncontrived, unsought Dharmakaya, without refusal or approval, enter into the spaciousness. At the core, that is unmoving, unthought, ubiquitous sameness, the vast matrix, the ground of being, furnishes inbuilt meaning. As immutable, ever-present Buddha in Buddha fields, we are instantly and innately empowered as Buddha. The universe is spontaneously liberated and perfect in the now. So do not strive to make alteration. Everything is already perfect. Everything unfolding as supreme, all-accomplishing spontaneity. In the self-sprung awareness in the now, where everything is singular spaciousness, our mode of experience is essentially non-dual. A continuity of dualistic perception may arise as creative display, but as luminous mind, appearances and their imputation are non-dual. In the luminous pure presence that cannot be altered or sublimated. As samsara or nirvana, the universal illusion appears, and that is to be neither abandoned nor dominated. For the adept in whom dualistic perception is dead, what is absent but apparent is a comic absurdity. In its very absence, appearance shines in multifarious variety. In its very absence, emptiness is all-pervading. In the absence of perceptual duality, we still perceive multiplicity. In the absence of underlying substance, we still transmigrate. In the absence of value judgment, we still distinguish pleasure and pain. Yet looking around, people's mistakes are astounding. Addicted to unreality as truth, they believe in a concrete reality. Addicted to delusion as gratification, they believe in delusion. Holding what is indeterminate as certain, they feign conviction. Holding what is not as what is, they are foolishly credulous. Holding what is valid as worthless, what is worthless seems validated. With the mind preoccupied by different petty concerns, a moment of inconsequential fixation becomes a habit. And a day, a month, a year, a lifetime goes by unheeded. We deceive ourselves by construing the non-dual as duality. When the adept with his pure mind looks inward, the nameless pure presence therein, ungrounded, beggars description, and view and meditation are irrelevant. Wide open, loose and spacious, in spaced out smoothness, there can be no sense of spiritual praxis, no distinction between sessions and breaks in meditation, everything unbounded and equalized, without disruption. Without body, object, or perception as a point of reference, because of the smoothness of the vast expanse of the sky, nothing experienced within can be construed as a self. Then looking outside at external appearances, everything seems evanescent, flimsy, transparent, and disassociated. No point of reference remains. Appearance, sound, and thought, every feeling is fresh and crisp. And thinking, am I mad? Am I dreaming? We burst out laughing. Without notions of friend and foe, love and hate, close and distant, no preferences for night or day, the sameness is the totality. And samsara, defined by attributes and reference points, has vanished. Without a thought of the field of self-sprung awareness, we have escaped the cage of belief in moral and perceptual duality. Without realization of non-dual pristine awareness, we have arrived at the self-sprung vision of the all-good, the place of no return, the point of consummation. Until we realize experientially that field of self-sprung sameness, we may verbally obsess with the phrase non-duality and speculate confidently about what is non-referential. But such egregious thinking is rude and stupid. So in the self-sprung modality, without sublimation or alteration, the sovereign consummate aspiration is fulfilled as non-duality. The three realms totally liberated as non-dual samsara and nirvana. The Dharmakaya citadel naturally arises within our inner nature, and it is immaculate, like the sky, we say, although it is actually incommensurable. As long as we fixate on this and that as separate beings, caught in duality, we are trapped in a cage of delusive self and other. When, on the contrary, we make no distinction between this and that, when all distinctions are smoothed out, points of reference has gone, then Vajrasattva affirms that non-duality is realized. Within the single matrix that is the vast expanse of our nature, sky-like luminous mind is the skybolt, and its quintessence, its real juice, by its very nature, shatters our confining shell. In this singular supermatrix, realization and non-realization, liberation and non-liberation are indivisible, sublime sameness. The Garuda bird, its wings fully developed within this egg, the moment it hatches, glides into the azure sky, outshining the Nagas, flying high above the great abyss. So the blessed adept, realizing the Vajra heart on the apex approach, outshines the lesser vehicles and crosses the void of samsara. To live in the supreme sameness, that is total liberation, inimical to those on the path of goal-oriented endeavor, validates the immutable sameness of the supreme approach. Everything is blissful in the sky-like Dharmakaya matrix. In this Dharmakaya matrix, nothing remains unliberated. Reality divulges itself as the sublime forms of the Vajra heart, while the karmically generated body is the heart's perfect creativity. When the conditioned body is abandoned in the bardo of life, everything is pure presence alone, in no way divisible. With the mastery of the victors on the level of spontaneity, emanation emerges without any restriction, and every situation is embraced without impediment. To ride the winds effortlessly defines the adept's career. And although, of course, it is inimical in the lower approaches, Ati accepts it as the crux of fruition. Birth occurs as unborn, magical emanation. While the fickle intellect fixates on causal relations, Ati reveals unconditional non-causality. And what is inadmissible in the lower approaches here becomes the crux. Buddha and sentient beings, the vision and the actuality, inseparable. It is the deluded intellect that holds samsara and nirvana apart. Ati reveals non-duality, and what is discordant in the lower approaches here becomes the crux. Realization and non-realization equally released. To believe in release through realization denies their equality. Ati reveals unitary sameness, and what is acceptable in the lower approaches here becomes the crux. Only an idiot relies on a specific method of attainment, for ineffable, non-specific realization, Ati reveals ultimacy to be indivisible, and what is inimical to the lower approaches here becomes the crux. All pervasive in the now, Dzogchen, is measureless, but it is only the idiot who calls it nebulous. Ati shows unbounded immediacy, and what is disagreeable in the lower approaches here becomes the crux. In the one soul sphere, the linear causal process is reversed, and sky-like sameness unravels goal-related hope and fear. It is vast, it is magnificent, a sky-like Buddha mind. Without goal fixation, the matrix of the one soul sphere, liberation in the now, whether or not we are realized. Happy the yogin on the sky-like path of non-action. This objectless pure presence of Buddha in the now supersedes the delusory ground and the roaming in samsara. No one can be deluded because no place of delusion exists. Here everything is intrinsic spaciousness in a single matrix of clarity. Samsara disposed in the now. There can be no attaining liberation or entering nirvana, for samsara and nirvana are unknown in the immutable supermatrix, and moral preference, hope, and fear are unimaginable. In the primordially luminous ground, in that vast matrix, all things are mere label. In reality, unutterable. So neither liberation nor delusion can exist. and samsara and nirvana are already resolved. Make no effort. Do not try and change things. Pure presence has no breadth or depth, no high or low. And this boundless indeterminacy precludes any point of reference. Pure presence has no agenda, nothing to do, and nowhere to go. And in the absence of linear time, an antidote precludes goal fixation. Any contrived point of reference results in captivity. So setting no goals whatsoever, relax into the totality, whether or not our experience is released in the now, whether or not our way of being is pure in its nature, whether or not the nature of mind is discursively elaborated, whether or not we bathe in the genuine, authentic disposition, it is all the same. Whether or not we see samsara and nirvana as a duality, whether or not all thought and expression is transcended, whether or not delusive logical thinking has been eradicated, whether or not the existential view has been actualized, it is immaterial. Whether or not we live in contemplation of reality, whether or not we live without discrimination, whether or not we live natural perfection as fruition, whether or not we have traversed the levels and paths, it is all beside the point. Whether or not we are free of all obscuration, whether or not creative and fulfillment stages have completed our reality, whether or not release has been attained as fruition, whether or not we wander in samsara's six mythic realms, it makes no difference. Whether or not the nature of our being is spontaneity, whether or not dualistic assertion and negation bind us, whether or not we have arrived at the ultimate vision of reality, whether or not we follow in the footsteps of our master, it does not matter. No matter what occurs, even if the sky and the earth change places, we are wide open, hanging loosely, authentic in groundlessness, without reference, disassociated, evanescent, randomized, without either hope or fear, we are uninhibited, divinely mad, view and meditation identical, the intellect's fixations collapse, and we are free of wishful thinking and goal orientation, and nothing to strive for or to practice remains. Whatever happens, let it happen. Whatever manifests, let it shine. Whatever arises, let it dawn. And whatever occurs, just let it be. And moreover, whatever is anything, let it be nothing at all. Our behavior become unpredictably varied. We are thrust immediately into pure presence, where computation of truth and untruth has no ground. Without reference, in boundless transparency, beyond the trap of philosophy, eating, moving, sleeping, sitting, day and night, a smooth continuum, we live in the sameness of the reality of our own nature. With no gods to worship, no spirits to exercise, no culture or meditation, in an unpretentious, free, and easy state, here is an unaffected Lord without pride in his sense of totality. And wide open, hanging loosely, in spontaneity and oneness, without need to act, secure in the now, stress-free, he is happy. The view is without ground in meditation is not a state. The view is without ground and meditation is not a state. So there is no discipline to pursue and no goal to attain, no preference anywhere. All distinctions smoothed away, without need of stress or strain, in zero dimension we are content. In the absence of ambition, all discipline practiced ends. And with nothing to lose, we let go of remedial strictures. Since neither something nor everything nor nothing exists, whatever appears, whatever occurs, is already released. Since no release by nature in the now or by itself is possible, the unreferenced totality has gone beyond resolution. So vast the matrix, so vast, a supermatrix, the spaciousness of space. In this all-embracing supermatrix, an all-saturating matrix of clarity, bliss and matrix swept into one unitary non-dual matrix, all things whatsoever are self-released, and reality is consummate. Unchangeable spontaneity is what I most desire for us all. Moreover, all of us, all those who follow my example, merging the all-embracing now with the super matrix, we have mastery on the level of the all good. It's a struggle. I'm definitely struggling with it. That's okay. It's not supposed to be perfected yet, right? We're still engaged in this struggle, so it's not perfect. I'm aware of all sorts of struggle, but we continue struggling forward here. Luminous mind with its alpha pure nature, the invariable reality that has nothing to expunge or espouse, a sky-like matrix, a reality that cannot be sought and found, shines as stellar light simply as we rest in its nature. The sensory fields do not crystallize here. Mind is not reified, and unmoving from essential spontaneity, we arrive at the guru vision of the all-good vast expanse. Crystal clear space, free of alternation and pulsation, like a still, unsullied, translucent ocean. In the simple clear reality of self-sprung awareness in the now, we rest free of fluctuating hope and fear. In a pre-verbal space, where there are no habitual compulsions, naturally disposed, unfeigned, uncontrived, and unalloyed, yes, absorbed by the matrix into the reality that has no attribute, neither meditation nor anything to meditate upon can be. Bipolarity set free becomes the self-sprung reality vision. All basic thought patterns are the creativity of pure presence. So renounced they may be, but they cannot be eliminated. In their reality, no differentiation or exclusion, no distinction can exist. So, may be present, but they cannot be definitively established. And their true reality is known simply as their spaciousness. Without rejecting samsara, we see it as self-sprung awareness in the now, envisioned through pure authenticity as the creativity of the supermatrix. In the now, sensory appearances and mind fall together as reality, where still contemplation occurs in an uninterrupted flow. This is the Vajra Peak, the supreme all-good Buddha mind, the most sublime spacious event as high as the sky, without differentiation or exclusion. The supreme meditation invests the now, marvelous Lord that is spontaneity. In the now, empowering clear light is a continuum, a spontaneity wherein nothing is expunged or espoused. This is the supreme vision of samsara and nirvana as spaciousness. This sky-like supermatrix itself, unmoving and ineffable, in the now, is the natural disposition of all beings. Seeing appearances as other than oneself is mental delusion. Belief in meditation and endeavor is mental delusion. The true reality of delusion is a field of sameness, a state of rest, But in that matrix that is unmoving and alpha pure, there can be no action or endeavor, no resting nor non-resting. Looking at the reality that is unchanging spontaneity, with its intrinsic presence that is free of intellectual interference. Looking again and again, we see nothing. Non-seeing is the empowering view of pure presence. In the undiscriminating pure presence that cannot be cultivated, pursuing meditation, we see nothing exists to meditate upon. Non-meditation is the empowering meditation of pure presence. In the non-dual way of being that is free of discrimination, in disciplined conduct, we see nothing exists to practice. Non-discipline is the empowering conduct of pure presence. Secure in the now, in the spontaneity free of hope and fear, in repetitive accomplishment, we see no accomplishment. Non-accomplishment is the empowering accomplishment of pure presence. In sameness, objects are not conceptualized, nor is mind reified, so fluctuating hope and fear subside. Living in the space where object and mind are identical, reality never moves out of the matrix. Nothing is objectified in the field of attributes, and so thereby we are empowered. In the now, through its non-dual empowering awareness, the great perfection, inseparable samsara and nirvana, without any giving or taking, is in all-pervasive smoothness. Matter and spirit are the same in intrinsic spaciousness, and Buddha and sentient beings are the same in intrinsic spaciousness, and absolute and relative are the same in intrinsic spaciousness, and sin and virtue are the same in intrinsic spaciousness, and the 10 directions are all the same in intrinsic spaciousness. Consequently, everything arising is self-sprung display. At its inception, all the same, nothing ever better or worse. What is the use of positive or negative antidotes? In their abiding, all things are the same, nothing ever better or worse. So let whatever arises in the mind subside into itself right now. In their release, all things are the same, nothing ever better or worse. So in the aftermath, why make any judgment? Everything arising as luminous mind in the ground of being arises as creativity or display. It is all indeterminate. Arising equally undetermined in the original matrix of the now, though it may seem to arise unambiguously, everything arises as the sameness of intrinsic spaciousness. Again, everything existing the same at rest in reality, though dissimilarity may appear to exist, everything abides in the sameness of intrinsic spaciousness. And again, released, self-sprung in the matrix of primal awareness, even though it may not appear to be released, it is actually released in the total sameness of spaciousness. In self-sprung presence, everything the same in the now. Arising or non-arising, everything is always absent in intrinsic spaciousness. Abiding or non-abiding, everything is always absent in intrinsic spaciousness. Released or unreleased, everything is always absent in intrinsic spaciousness. In the pure presence of immutable sameness, at inception, spontaneously arising, everything is known in its intrinsic state. As it abides, spontaneously abiding, everything is known in its intrinsic state. And at dissolution, spontaneously dissolving, everything is known in its intrinsic state. In pure presence, unchanging and unelaborated, everything arising arises in the now. Everything abiding abides in the now. Everything dissolving is released in the now, and its nature is like the sky. coincident arising, abiding, and release in an uninterrupted flow. No break in the arising and dissolving is possible. In an